Peruchim Habayim, I would like to welcome you to this interfaith service of remembrance. We gather this evening to commemorate Kristallnacht, the Night of Broken Glass, in a beautiful interfaith program that reminds us that what affects one of us affects all of us. After the close of the Eichmann trial, the New York Times asked editorially, what was the object and justification of the trial? The answer it gave to this question is worth pondering. Rabbi Sidney Greenberg responded, it was and it is to do all that can be done to eradicate an evil thing out of our civilization, a thing so incredibly wicked that it would not have been believable of modern man if it had not actually occurred. This evil, this wickedness began with intolerance and hate in a few people's hearts. It spread until it almost wrecked the world. Now the obligation is to remember, not in hate, not in the spirit of revenge, but so that this spirit cannot ever flourish again, so long as humankind remains on earth. And to this end, let us begin, each of us, by looking into our own hearts. Tonight, we stand together to remember and honor the lives of those shattered by the evil of the Holocaust.
Martin Niemöller, a pastor who opposed Hitler and was arrested and confined for treason in 1937, authored this famous poem describing the dangers of apathy and silence. First they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak out for me. Words from Pope Francis on the anniversary of Kristallnacht. We renew our closeness and solidarity to the Jewish people, our big brothers, and pray to God that the memory of the past and of the sins of the past helps us to be always vigilant and against every form of hate and intolerance. You cannot live your Christianity, you cannot be a real Christian, if you do not recognize your Jewish roots in the religious sense. Interreligious dialogue needs to deepen in this, in Christianity's Jewish root and in the Christian flowering of Judaism. I understand it is a challenge, but it can and must be done as brothers and sisters.
Thank you. Good evening. I want to begin by thanking the staff of the Fish Interface Center and all of the participants in tonight's service, our extraordinary student readers, our incredible musicians, my colleagues, Dean Gail Stearns, Rabbi Cora Yutkin. It's wonderful to be back on campus for this event, which we are also live streaming for those at a distance. Tonight, as you know, is an evening of remembrance and hope. Given the focus of our remembrance, Kristallnacht, a night of violence and destruction, hope might seem out of place. In truth, those two words, memory and hope, are in tension with one another. Remembering what occurred in a country renowned for its learning and culture would seem to be cause for despair, not hope. We can well ask, what is the purpose of learning if it does not prevent such acts? And have we learned from our past? Or perhaps better said, what have we learned from the past? How to hate one another? How to dehumanize one another? Have we not learned that the person who hates, who demeans and abuses another, destroys not only their target, but themselves? So often, it would seem, we have not learned. We can point to many reasons for that, and ignorance of the past is one. I would argue that the transformative hope for our present and future can come about only when we challenge ourselves to wrestle with the worst in our past. And where better can that happen than at a university? Where better than at this university? In his Nobel Peace Prize address, Holocaust survivor and author Elie Wiesel said, "We thought it would be enough to tell of the tidal wave of hatred which broke over the Jewish people." I'm sorry, having a little asthma attack. "For people everywhere to decide once and for all to put an end to hatred of anyone who is different, whether black or white, Jew or Arab, Christian or Muslim, anyone whose orientation differs politically, philosophically, socially," unquote. And as we all know, it has not been enough. But as we come together tonight, united as a community of memory, hearing from those who experienced Kristallnacht and from those representing Jewish, Christian, Muslim, and Baha'i traditions, we have reason for hope. 8 years ago, on the 75th anniversary of Kristallnacht, we were privileged to hear from four individuals who experienced that terrible night of fear and destruction. A little later in the program, we will play video excerpts from that extraordinary evening. Following the recording, I invite you to stand and applaud in recognition of our dear friend, Angelina Billauer, who is joining us via Zoom. We love you, Angelina. As many of you know, on the night of November 9th, 1938, a wave of anti-Semitic violence swept across Germany and Austria. It left in its wake thousands of shattered windows and ransacked businesses, hundreds of smoldering and desecrated synagogues, and almost 100 Jewish dead. Until that evening, Nazi persecution of Jews had been conducted under the cover of law, starting already in April 1933. In 1935, the Nazi government stripped Jews of their German citizenship and prohibited marriage with non-Jews. Dozens of regulations and decrees followed. Jews could not attend public school or university. Jews could not own a car or a bicycle or a typewriter or even a pet. Jews could not attend a concert or see a movie or go to a restaurant. Propaganda and promises persuaded the many to silently acquiesce in the persecution of the few: Jews, gays, Roma, Afro-Germans. But there were a few who did not acquiesce. For more than a decade, despite libel suits and death threats, writers and editors of the Munich Post, the newspaper the Nazis labeled, quote, the poison kitchen, courageously published expose after expose about the Nazis and their leader. They refused to allow a free press to be silenced. They continued to speak their minds until March 1933, when the Nazis banned all opposition newspapers. Soon thereafter, Nazi thugs pillaged the newspaper's office, destroyed their printing press, and imprisoned the paper's editors and reporters. The police stood by without intervening, an eerie precursor of what would happen on November 9th, 1938. Even the newspaper street address was obliterated. Only a few days after that event, Dachau, the first permanent concentration camp, opened on March 20th. Over the next years, thousands of politicians, lawyers, judges, pastors, priests, nuns, journalists, and educators would be sent to Dachau and other camps throughout Germany. By the end of 1937, almost 1,000 pastors of the Confessing Church, the segment of the Evangelical or Lutheran churches organized in resistance to the Nazi-supported state church, were imprisoned in concentration camps. Many of them would die there. The Nazis portrayed the events of November 9th and 10th, 1938, as a spontaneous demonstration of anger following the murder of a German diplomat in Paris by a Jewish teenager. Herschel Greenspan had become distraught after learning that his Polish-born parents, who had lived in Germany since 1911, had been deported, refused entry into Poland, and continued and confined in a squalid no man's land between the two countries. We know that the Nazi leadership had been waiting for just such a pretext to escalate their persecution of the Jews. On November 10th, the morning after the violence, the Nazis arrested some 28,000 Jewish men and teenagers. Among those teenagers was cantor Leopold Schneer, of blessed memory, whose recorded voice you will hear this evening. Yet terrible as those events were, they were only a prelude to what no one, not even the perpetrators themselves, could yet imagine: a genocide that would claim 6 million Jewish lives and the lives of perhaps 1 million Roma, mentally and physically disabled, homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses, and the children of French colonial soldiers and German mothers. All who did not stand at the top of the Nazi racial hierarchy or who dared to think differently were targeted. Universities, their faculty, staff, and students, for the most part, remained silent. But for some, including a small group of students at the University of Munich, who would later become the White Rose resistance movement, Kristallnacht marked the beginning of a new awareness. In 1942, they chose active resistance, daring to print illegal pamphlets calling for a different Germany, one dedicated to, quote, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and protection of the individual citizen, unquote. They continued the legacy of the brave journalists of the Munich Post. For publishing those forbidden words, words like freedom, six of them were tried and beheaded. Sophie Scholl was 21 years old. Their courage testifies to the fact that throughout the 12 years of the Third Reich, people of different beliefs, faiths, and walks of life, a courageous minority, rejected the Nazi ideology with its hierarchy of humanity. Tonight, on the 83rd anniversary of Kristallnacht, we remember all those who were persecuted and all those who stood with them, who rejected silence and indifference. May their memory give us hope and empower, indeed demand of us, to create a more just and humane world.
An Action Against the Jews by Arnold Blum. I stood before the burning shul and watched as the firemen protected the surrounding buildings, being careful not to put any water on isolated curls of smoke rising here and there from the devastated sanctuary that once was our shul. I stood before the burning shul, unbelievingly, in deep shock, empty of strength, gutted, as was our shul. A murder had been committed, symbolic as it were, soon to be followed by the near annihilation of our people. Slowly, my senses returned in a wave of anger. I clenched my fists, my eyes filled with tears of outrage. My silence screamed, Kuma Adonai, Ve'afutsu Oviecha, rise up, Lord, and scatter your enemies. But the clouds did not part. The shofar did not sound. The strong hand and the outstretched arm did not appear. It was not the year of the Lord. He had averted his face.
A testimony by Herbert Lindermeyer. At the time of Kristallnacht, I wasn't home. I was in a different town. My father was arrested. My father was in Buchenwald until December, about 4 or 5 weeks. Then he was released because he was a war veteran. He had received an Iron Cross for valor. He was in sad shape when he came home. It took him quite a while to recover. Then he was more or less convinced there was no future, and he took steps to emigrate. But by that time, it was too late. I know to get an American visa or American papers in January, there was a waiting list. I still remember our number. It was 44,444. So I can never forget that number.
Evening of November 8th. At night, we smelled fire, we heard explosions, but we lived near a synagogue, but we didn't dare go out to see what's going on. The next morning, I went to school. I had a 45-minute walk to school because we were forbidden to use public transportation. On the way, I passed a Jewish neighborhood, a Jewish street, a street where mostly jewelry stores were, that were owned by Jews. The glass was all over the streets. the SA and the brown shirt men were standing, yelling, screaming, "Don't buy from Jews. We want to get rid of the Jews." I walked to school. Of course, we were dismissed, and I had to walk back through the same tragedy home.
Kristallnacht 1938. It is a moment of unforgettable pictures and experience. Imagine going to school in the morning on a sunny day in Berlin, on the bicycle, expecting nothing evil. An hour into the class, the director of the school herself, Dr. Leonora Goldschmidt, came running around and said, "Go home, get to your bicycle, hurry up. We are surrounded by Hitler Youth and by SS and SA. They are throwing stones. Don't make eye contact." Yes, I made it home. But there is something that you cannot avoid, and that's a touch of culture shock and fear, because my family had lived a totally integrated life in Germany until the little town of East Prussia, with Hitler coming into their government, suddenly found us, five boys in the whole school, isolated because we were Jews, we were outsiders, we should be beaten up. And the teachers could not defend us because they would lose their job. My father moved us to Berlin. There was a Jewish directorship in this particular school, and we had a smooth sailing for about a year. My father's career as a lawyer was finished. He was not allowed to go to court any longer. And naturally, there was the possibility of finding a way to get out of Germany. But my father was an eternal optimist. "Hitler is a madman. What can they do? The German people will realize that this cannot last." And now, my flashback to Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass. I ran back from school. The director told us to do that. I got home. My parents were very worried. And I really had a sort of culture shock, because our life was integrated. And now, all of a sudden, we were outsiders again. And I was 12, I was almost 13 years old, put away the calculators. I was being prepared for bar mitzvah, to become an adult. However, it was very difficult, because coming home, my mother walked me to the window, and what I saw was smoke, and the smoke was from the Fasanstrasse synagogue, two blocks away, where the bar mitzvah was going to take place. But the pictures of Jude scrabbled on the glass and smashed, the looting, the mob, the screaming, was something that I shall never forget. It's a picture engraved in one's mind.
Kristallnacht found me in Dinslaken, Germany, in a Kinderheim that was actually conducted by Dr. Rothschild, one of the Rothschild family. We had an ordinary day that day. It was the 9th of November, and somehow we had just dinner, and things were going along fine. And suddenly all the lights went out. We were just terribly shocked because then it became totally dark. And my best friend and I, Kate, grabbed each other by the hand and we tried to run to the beginning of the dining room. I didn't hear any our counselors were shouting directions that we neither of us were hearing, and as we were trying to get into the front of the dining room, we encountered an invasion, it seemed, of strangers, big men with heavy black boots and stomping all around us. Like one person, we flew into the pantry and kind of found refuge amongst all the amongst paper goods and brooms and whatever happens to be in the pantry. There was an enormous amount of crystal being broken down. We heard glass chattering and thundering sounds, and suddenly we watched in horror as all our furnishings in the dining room were thrown through what used to be just a few minutes ago doors and windows. We saw that even from the upstairs, all our belongings and the beddings were being thrown in the backyard into our playground where usually there were swings and fun equipment for us to use. The next day, it was the tenth of November. We were able to get back to the Kinderheims, the backyard where all the items were thrown, and there was just chaos all over. And I was viewing what was going on around me with all the rubble that was on the floor. And lo and behold, a miracle happened. I saw my photo album sticking out from amongst all the rubble that had been thrown there the night before. Was picked everything up, and my pictures were just here and there and everywhere, and I was able to find all of them and put them together. And I must say that those pictures were presented for me my identity, my very being, because that's all that was really proving that I existed. And it was going to be my identity for many years.
I wanted absolutely to see my synagogue. My parents, may they rest in peace, never agreed to this. The day goes by, another day. It is November the 12th, and I did, like some other kids do today, not listen to my parents. And I swindled myself out, and I went to the synagogue. I mean, it was a catastrophe. And people were around there and were speaking to each other about this was my goodness. So I said to the people, isn't it a shame what they did to this synagogue? But it didn't take long. I was taken from both sides. Two men in civil take me away. Where did they take me? To Dachau.
Please stand and applause in honor of all survivors and our dear friend, Angelina Bilauer. I think we should applaud Daniel. It's my pleasure to welcome back to Chapman University for his second year as Presidential Fellow, Dr. Glenn Kurtz. Dr. Kurtz first spoke at Chapman in September 2018 when he shared the extraordinary story of discovering his grandparents' 1938 vacation film, which included 3 minutes of footage from Poland. His book, 3 Minutes in Poland, Discovering a Lost World in a 1938 Family Film, traces his journey to restore names and identities to some of the Jews of Nieszczelsk, a village poised on the edge of destruction in the Holocaust. Copies of 3 Minutes in Poland are available for purchase, and Dr. Kurtz has agreed to sign copies after our event. Those are available in the vestibule. A documentary film based on Dr. Kurtz's book premiered at the Venice Film Festival this past September. It is screened at the Telluride and Toronto Film Festivals and will receive its New York premiere this weekend at the Doc NYC Festival. The film is directed by Dutch historian and film critic Bianca Stigter, co-produced by Academy Award director for 12 Years a Slave, Steve McQueen, and narrated by Helena Bonham Carter. Tonight, Dr. Kurtz will tell us about present-day Nieszczelsk and a program that addresses the challenge of passing down historical memory to a new generation while bridging the divide between Holocaust-era Polish history and Jewish history. By inviting students to explore the 400 years of multi-ethnic coexistence that defined the town prior to the Holocaust, this program engages difficult issues at the heart of contemporary Polish-Jewish relations by asking who is included in our history. Dr. Kurtz holds a doctorate in German studies and comparative literature from Stanford University. He is also a graduate of the New England Conservatory Tufts University graduate degree program and is an accomplished classical guitarist. We are so glad that Dr. Kurtz will be with us for the next 2 weeks, teaching classes and speaking next Tuesday at 7 p.m. on a fascinating topic in American history, on which he is currently writing a book. Flyers for that event are available on the table in the foyer. Please join me now in welcoming Dr. Glenn Kurtz, who will speak on the topic, Who Will Tell Our History?
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Haran, for that marvelous introduction. Thank you to Dean Keen and Provost Bouchard, Dr. Stearns, to the Chapman community for inviting me back again. It's a pleasure to be here, and it feels very much like a home away from home. Standing here tonight, it feels almost as if I was just here for the last Kristallnacht commemoration. Was it a month ago, a few months, a year? At the same time, given all of that has transpired since then, it feels as if that time belonged to a different era, a different life. Like many of you, I suspect, I suffer from COVID time warp, where the present feels like a long, continuous blur, and the past feels undifferentiated and unbridgeably remote. I think it's worth dwelling on this feeling for a moment, because it is perhaps every educator's fear that young students encountering history, even recent history, even history within our own lifetimes or the lifetimes of those still living, will feel the same way. The present is an all-absorbing blur, and the past when it exists at all, seems like a mythical before time, existing all at once in some remote semi-reality. The development of historical consciousness is hard won, demanding long and arduous study, cultural sensitivity, and above all, attentiveness to what distinguishes past eras from the present, the nuances of thought and manner and behavior, so that people of a previous era are not reduced to simple black and white versions of ourselves. It's sobering, therefore, to experience how readily even our own past, our own history, gets flattened out, even especially in the aftermath of a trauma, however mild our recent experience may be compared to that of people who lived in Europe in the 1930s and 40s. Concerning the history of the Holocaust era, it's a cliched note that we live in a moment of transition, as the voices of the generation that lived through those events grows quieter. It's left to a new generation to preserve that history, generations who never experienced it and who understand it solely through study and interpretation. It's the responsibility of these generations to cultivate their own historical consciousness so that the irreducible complexity and human tragedy of the Holocaust is not flattened out to a simple story of evil Nazis and Jewish victims, something that happened long ago in a place far away in some remote half-reality that has little to do with us. And yet, I believe this is exactly what will inevitably happen, or sadly, what has already happened for the vast majority of young students. As we commemorate the 83rd anniversary of Kristallnacht, it's once again sobering to realize how terribly soon it will be the 90th anniversary, the 100th. What will students born today know about the Holocaust when they are 15 or 20? How many will have developed a nuanced historical consciousness capable of approaching that history with subtlety and interpretive sophistication and passing it on in a meaningful way? These are questions that I know many of the professors here wrestle with daily. It can feel like a hopeless task, but this is, of course, the reason why it must be done, however inadequately and however thankless, even futile, it may feel. I'm not a historian. I wrestle with these questions in a more general, more local way, through my involvement with a small town in Poland where my grandfather was born, a place I've been visiting now for going on 10 years. So rather than presenting the conclusions of my research, I wish to share with you a work in progress, a report on an experiment in attempting to foster historical consciousness in a place where there are many impediments to learning the history of the Holocaust beyond simply the passage of time. But first, some background. As Dr. Haran mentioned, in 1938, my grandfather, David Kurtz, took a European vacation with my grandmother and three friends. And on this trip, he visited Naszalsk, Poland, about 35 miles north of Warsaw, the town where he was born in 1888, and from which he and his family emigrated soon after. On this 1938 return trip, David Kurtz brought with him a 16 millimeter home movie camera, and he captured 3 minutes of footage of the town's Jewish population. Here's a brief excerpt. Remarkably, much of the film is in color. Just a brief excerpt. I discovered this film in my parents' closet in 2009. It had languished for more than 70 years, considered little more than a tourist souvenir. It was a stunning, life-changing moment when I first saw it as an adult and recognized that the film is also an invaluable historical artifact, very likely preserving the only imagery of people who would very soon be murdered. At the time, I didn't even know the name of the town it showed. But I felt a profound sense of responsibility to the people who appear in the film. And I spent the next 5 years attempting to give names to the faces in these haunting, silent images, and to recover the history and memory of these people as individuals with the same degree of detail that the film had captured of their physical appearance. Eventually, I was able to identify the town as Nashelsk, and over the years of research, I ultimately met 8 survivors, including 2 who appear in the film as children. This research was my entree to the small town of Nashelsk, to its current population and local culture, and to its relation to its own history. On my first visit to Nashelsk in 2012, I brought with me the fears and suspicions and prejudicial wariness so characteristic of American Jews in their attitude towards Poland and Poles. I was shocked, but hardly surprised, that there was no mention of the Jewish population on the history page of the town's official website, despite the fact that for 400 years, Jews accounted for half of the town's population. I was shocked, but hardly surprised, that there was no mention and no memorial of the 3,000 Jewish citizens who were murdered out of a total population of 4,500, or that none of the appropriated buildings, from private homes to the synagogue to the yeshiva, which now houses the town's high school, bore any commemorative plaque recognizing their origin or their former owners. Growing up in a predominantly Jewish suburb of New York City, I had passively absorbed the stereotypes of Poland prevalent among American Jews, that all Poles are anti-Semites, that during the war, Poles were collaborators. The Polish Jewish survivors I encountered considered the Poles worse than the Germans. Of course, I didn't recognize these as prejudices. I thought of them as historical facts. And thus, it was shocking, but not surprising, to see superficial confirmation of what I expected to find. But perhaps the first requirement for developing historical consciousness is developing it in yourself. As is common in many Polish towns, here's, sorry, a brief picture of attempting to locate the scene of my grandfather's film. As is common in many Polish towns, it often falls to a single individual to be the keeper of Jewish history. This is not a popular job, and the person who performs it is typically ostracized or faces outright hostility from other members of the community. But visiting Nashelsk, I was fortunate to meet Zdzisław Suwiński, who had been studying the town's Jewish history for many years before I showed up, and who performed his role with skill, perseverance, and grace. Mr. Suwiński is a trained historian and was at the time the director of the high school, a well-respected member of the community whom everyone knew. Perhaps more importantly, he was a humane and sympathetic guide to the complexities of historical memory in Poland. His family had also suffered grievously at the hands of the Nazis, and he expressed deep shame at the conduct of Poles under German occupation. Nevertheless, he kept his interest in Jewish history private. It was not something that made its way into his history classes at the high school. Those in town who knew of his strange attachment to Jewish history dismissed it as an eccentricity. And when I expressed my dismay at the complete absence of Jews from the town's official history, Mr. Suwiński, who was raised and educated under the communist regime, shook his head. He was not hopeful about the prospect of changing local attitudes or developing the town's historical consciousness. And perhaps as a local, he was hesitant to push too hard. Mr. Suwiński's family had lived in Nashelsk for generations, and his children and grandchildren still live there. As an outsider, however, I had no particular affection for the town and no connection to its present. My only interest was in its past. I may have had historical sensitivity, but I had no local sensitivity. Therefore, I also had no compunction against disturbing local sensibilities. I felt that it was wrong, that it falsified history to leave out the story of the Jewish population. And coming from New York, I had no personal stake in the town's life or culture. And so, with my grandfather's film as evidence, and quietly guided by Mr. Suvinsky's insider's expertise in town politics, I undertook to intervene in the town's historical memory. On that first trip to Poland, I was also extraordinarily fortunate to have encountered the Forum for Dialogue, a nonprofit educational organization based in Warsaw. The Forum for Dialogue, which many of you may know about, and the director of the American Friends of the Forum is here with us tonight, is dedicated to fostering dialogue between Poles and Jews, or to speak more accurately, between non-Jewish and Jewish people of Polish heritage. One of the Forum's signature programs is the School of Dialogue, a semester-long seminar in which high school students are asked to research the Jewish history of their own town. It's an extraordinary program, and the Forum's young, energetic, and highly trained staff is expert in skillfully diffusing the suspicion surrounding investigating local history. To date, the Forum has conducted the School of Dialogue in almost 400 high schools throughout Poland. With support from Mr. Suvinsky and his successor at the high school, we brought the School of Dialogue to Nieszczalsk in the spring of 2014. And in the context of that semester, we arranged for Maurice Chandler, born Moshe Tuchhändler, in Nieszczalsk in 1924, to speak with the students. Mr. Chandler is one of the two survivors who appear in my grandfather's film. And he'll celebrate his 97th birthday next week. To me, this meeting was earth-shaking. Jewish history returns to Nieszczalsk. And to Mr. Chandler, who fled as a 14-year-old yeshiva student, the opportunity to speak to young Poles in his hometown was deeply meaningful. I cannot say what impact this conversation had on the students, nor what effect their participation in the School of Dialogue has had on them subsequently. What I can say is that there was no pedagogical follow-up, although the School of Dialogue could not have taken place without the cooperation of the new director of the high school, there was no second School of Dialogue the following year, no discernible change in the town's attitudes. The small group of students who participated went on to graduate and to take that experience with them. In short, the program took place, and then, as far as I could tell, nothing changed. I was naive. With each development, the discovery of the film, holding the school for dialogue, meeting Mr. Chandler, I expected something. Maybe not a Jewish festival in the market square, but perhaps a plaque on the high school, stating that the building had been built by David Leib Schmerlach, and that before the war, it had housed the yeshiva. I expected some public recognition on the part of the town administration, some public correction of the truncated history the town told about itself. Or, failing this, I hoped at least that one teacher or one resident, aside from Mr. Suvinsky, would step forward as a partner in preserving what I understood as an essential, neglected element of local history. None of this happened. As far as I could tell, nothing happened at all. But having begun, I felt committed. And I confess, there was an element of taunting in my attitude. Maybe you don't want to remember, but I'm not going away. 2014 was also the 75th anniversary of the deportation of Nieszczalsk's Jewish population. In the course of researching and writing my book about my grandfather's film, I'd built an informal community of survivors, survivor families, and descendants, and I reached out to this circle and proposed that we return to Nieszczalsk to commemorate this anniversary. To my great surprise, more than 50 people agreed to join me. It was the largest contingent of Jews in Nashelsk since 1939. It was a powerful, emotional experience for many of those who participated, some of whom had visited the town in earlier times and received a cold reception, many of whom had never been there before. We met with the mayor, we met with the high school students. I helped arrange a photo exhibit showing the town's Jewish community in the years prior to the war, and invited the whole town to the opening. And there was some contact with the local population, a few people engaged in discussions, comparing recollections, or stories passed down from parents and grandparents. But this earth-shaking event, too, took place and then passed. And while it has had a lasting effect upon the descendants, it's unclear what effect it had on the town. What I did not understand at the time, however, was that this was also the first opportunity for local residents to meet members of the Polish Jewish diaspora. Most people in town had never met a Jew, let alone one who considered their town their hometown. And ideas that local residents had, especially young residents, were formed entirely on hearsay, tradition, and prejudice. The chance to meet and speak with living Jews, or, as happened, merely to observe them from windows or from across the street, may have been more meaningful than I grasped at the time. During the trip in 2014, the descendants were particularly disturbed that the Jewish cemetery, while preserved as a distinct space, had otherwise remained entirely neglected and uncared for. Beginning in 2016, then, as a way of creating an ongoing opportunity for person-to-person contact, and of course because it was a worthy goal in itself, a group of descendants began to spend a week each year cleaning and restoring the cemetery. Each year, we added some element in memory of the Jewish community, a historical marker there on the lower left, giving a brief sketch of the Jewish community's history, and a memorial plaque in the upper right, created by a survivor's 15-year-old great-granddaughter, which stated simply, "In loving memory of the Jewish community of Nashelsk." Finally, as I talked about in my previous Kristallnacht talk in 2019 here, we succeeded in recovering elements of the demolished synagogue. Pieces of the synagogue windows had ended up in a private home where they formed an elegant sunroom for half a century. We made an arrangement with the town's current owner, or the home's current owner, and recovered these windows, incorporating them into this memorial gate. Due to COVID, the memorial sat in a warehouse for more than a year. It was finally installed in March 2021 without any descendants present. Each time we visited, with each new addition to this memorialization of the Jewish community, we invited local residents to join us. We would hold small events, a talk, a dinner, a photo exhibit, at which members of the descendants group and the local community could interact, exchange views, share a meal, a drink. A few people would show up. We developed friendships with a small handful of people who would join us each year. But during most of this time, the community at large, while clearly aware of our presence, kept their distance. Yet, quietly, invisibly to me, our presence had made an impression. Perhaps simply acclimating to the idea that Jewish history was part of the town and that actual living Jews might play a role in local culture was itself an essential precursor to a subtle shift in attitudes and atmosphere. In April 2019, for example, without any prompting from us, a group of local residents spent several hours cleaning garbage from the cemetery. And one of the members of this group sent me this photograph on Facebook with the caption, "Happy Passover." And when the memorial gate was finally installed in 2021, a journalist from the local paper contacted me for an interview. She wanted me to comment on the significance of this new public sculpture on the edge of town. In the context of that interview, I mentioned my hope that residents, especially students, would understand that Jewish history was not something separate from local history, but rather that the two were deeply intertwined. I expressed the hope that the sharp boundary between Polish history and Jewish history, maintained by both communities, would soften. And without knowing it, I had found the person I'd been searching for all along. The journalist, Olga Iskevich, happens to be a kindergarten teacher. And within a few months, she had organized a team of educators in other schools in Neshelsk, and they had crafted a proposal to introduce a full year of activities across the curriculum in every grade. It's worth reading the brief preamble from her proposal. This project aims to awaken sensitivity to Jewish culture related to the history of Neshelsk. The project fosters the development of intercultural competence, shaping the attitude of tolerance towards cultural diversity, searching for the common denominator between Polish and Jewish cultures, respecting other people as individuals and as members of the community. Its purpose is to encourage and motivate the younger generation to broaden their historical knowledge both locally and internationally. Well, perhaps to us, educators in the United States and students steeped in the language of diversity, this preamble may sound bland or routine, but it would be hard to overestimate how revolutionary it is coming from a small town in Poland. Together with her team, Olga reached out to numerous organizations, the Forum for Dialogue, the Polin Museum of the History of Jews in Poland in Warsaw, the Krakow JCC, as well as to theater, dance, and other cultural organizations dedicated to preserving Jewish culture in Poland. And the results of this work are unfolding even as we speak. Here are some events just from the past month. Kindergarten students are learning the Hebrew alphabet, not only how to write it, but how to shape it with their bodies. Middle school students participate in a program called Museum in a Box, where they learn about objects related to Jewish culture. This is led by specialists from the Polin Museum. High school students spent a day clearing the cemetery and learning about its significance in Jewish tradition. And finally, high school students, once again, thank you. Olga deserves the praise. High school students also, once again, had the opportunity to listen to and ask questions of Mr. Chandler about his experience in town as a boy. Upcoming programs will include Jewish cooking, literature by Polish Jewish authors, performance of Yiddish theater, and the students will learn to perform a ritual marriage ceremony. Our hope is that this program will be adopted as a regular part of the school curriculum so that year after year, as part of their regular coursework, students will learn about Jewish culture that once flourished in Neshelsk. And as the scholars Michal Bielewicz and Anna Stefaniak have shown, this approach to teaching Jewish history is often more effective than the traditional Holocaust education, which tends to emphasize what happened to the Jews, and so maintain a methodological and cultural division that is itself already highly problematic. By learning that Poland, in particular their hometown, was always home to a diverse culture, and that this diversity is Polish, students are challenged to redefine what it means to be Polish. Rather than a national identity based upon the idea of a true Pole, students are introduced to a multicultural identity. And as Bielewicz and Stefaniak write, prior to World War II, the country had a highly diverse population with ethnic Poles constituting only 69.2% of the total. The Jewish minority was the second largest at 10.5%. Currently, the Jewish population in Poland is 0.1%. Bielewicz and Stefaniak refer to this form of intercultural pedagogy as prejudice-reducing intervention. And amazingly, even in the current political climate in Poland, such an education is possible. But as I learned, and as should have been obvious to me from the start, it cannot be imposed from outside. Instead, it depends on the courage and motivation of local teachers. Undoubtedly, the presence and the participation of the descendants can help to encourage an atmosphere in which such participation is accepted and effective. Our many years of understated work in the town certainly contributed to this remarkable development, if only by demonstrating that places like the synagogue should be cared for, or that artifacts like the remaining fragments of the synagogue still hold meaning for us. And for a small town like Nieszczelsk, which can share the provincialism of small towns everywhere, it's also worth highlighting the surprise, indeed the astonishment, students experience when they learn that people from the United States, the United Kingdom, Canada, Australia, Argentina, Paraguay, and Israel, among other countries, think of their town as their ancestral home and feel a sense of kinship with it, however fraught. I cannot overemphasize how utterly remarkable it is that these events are taking place in Nieszczelsk. At the same time, and in conclusion, I think it's worth asking, at the end of this program, what will these students know about Jewish history? It does not diminish the work of these fine educators and the enormous effort it took to build the curriculum and organize this cultural programming to give the answer, not very much. Students may learn to write their name with Hebrew characters or learn to dance the hora. Perhaps some students will retain an impression of meeting Mr. Chandler and of learning of the horrors he faced when he was the same age they are now. They will not learn much about Jewish culture or Jewish history. They will not learn what we might call our history. By our, I mean, of course, what Jews think of as their history, but also what those who study and try to pass on the lessons of the Holocaust consider history. To us, the fate of the Jewish population in Poland is the central piece of knowledge these students ought to have. And in our anger, our grief, our bitterness at the murder of our ancestors, the first thing that we tend to ask of Polish students is, what do they know about the Holocaust? But as a matter of pedagogy, this approach inevitably provokes resistance. It emphasizes feelings of guilt and anger and competitive victimhood. The typical response on an insistence of Jewish suffering is, but Poles suffered too. To the students of Nieszczelsk, the fate of the town's Jewish population only makes sense. It only has human significance when understood in the context of the town's identity. The murder of half of the town's population only touches these students when they think of the victims as fellow citizens. And this realization only occurs once students discover that for hundreds of years, their hometown was very different from the one they know today, that it was multi-ethnic, multicultural, and that the Polish identity that they have inherited and that is so pronounced in contemporary politics is not the only one possible or available, that it is, in fact, an ideological construction. These students tend not to respond when Jewish history is the subject, but by studying these aspects of local history, they learn something about Polish identity that they did not know, and this knowledge may change them. I believe there's a lesson here for us as well. For us, too, reducing Jewish history in Poland solely to its horrific end is a failure of imagination. itself a kind of prejudice, which distorts the richness and significance and the variety and contradictions of the culture that was brought to so violent an end. To understand what the Holocaust means in cultural terms, we must understand what was lost. And for many of us, this means reimagining and expanding our idea of who we are. Because if Polish history is also Jewish history, then Jewish history in Poland is also Polish. And one thing I've learned from Mr. Chandler is how deeply meaningful Polish culture is to him. The songs, the food, the manners and customs. When we say never forget, we do not mean that everyone should become a historian of the Holocaust. We mean instead, I think, that on some basic level, everyone should know the facts of the Holocaust, should recognize its barbarity as the result of unchecked anti-Semitism, and should experience this knowledge as a terrible warning and a profound, devastating human wound. It's the thesis of our experiment in Nashelsk that a more effective way to convey this knowledge is not to begin at the end with statistics or a field trip to Auschwitz without any cultural context. Instead, the full horror of the Holocaust is brought home to these students by emphasizing the multifaceted, vibrant, complex history of Jewish life in Poland. And this means the food, the dances, the literature, and the rituals of the Jewish community that once thrived there. Perhaps, having learned about this life, the students in Nashelsk too will experience the destruction of this community, indeed the destruction of this Poland, as a loss. And as a consequence of having felt this loss as something affecting their own lives and their own town, perhaps they will have a personal stake in ensuring that it never happens again. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. A reading from the foreword by Mordecai Paldiel and Norman H. Gershman. Beisa, Muslims Who Saved Jews in World War II. As elsewhere during World War II, Jews in Albania were especially targeted for destruction by the ruling Germans. But their fate there was altered by an ancient and sacrosanct principle known as Beisa, one's word of honor. As a result, nearly all of the 2,000 Jews in Albania were spared the furnaces of Auschwitz, for they were hidden or otherwise sheltered by the mostly Muslim population. Survivors relate that Albanians vied with each other for the honor of sheltering the fleeing Jews. This Islamic behavior of compassion and mercy celebrates the sanctity of life in a view of the other, the stranger, as indeed one's own closest family member.
An excerpt from the Promulgation of Universal Peace, written by Abdu'l-Bahá. Do not exalt yourselves above others, but consider all as your equals, recognizing them as the servants of one God. Know that God is compassionate towards all. Therefore, love all from the depths of your hearts. Act in such a way that your heart may be free from hatred. Be the source of consolation to every sad one. Assist every weak one. Be helpful to every indigent one. Care for every sick one. Be the cause of glorification to every lowly one. And shelter those who are overshadowed by fear. In brief, let each one of you be as a lamp, shining forth with the light of the virtues of the world of humanity.
So as we get close to the end, I want to thank you all for being here this evening. Thank you to Dr. Kurtz. Thank you so much. That was really, really fascinating, enlightening. To our musicians, thank you so much. Student members of the Interfaith Council, thank you. We have students here in Interfaith Leadership class, and it's delightful to have you all here this evening. Thanks for your meetings. Beautiful. And one person who has not been thanked, who will not thank herself, thank you, Dr. Marilyn Herron. On this 14th year in a row, we have gathered as an interfaith community to remember Kristallnacht, that fateful night, and all that was to come. So why do we gather as an interfaith community? As far as we know, this is the only gathering of its kind that is that happens across the country. In his book, 3 Minutes in Poland, Dr. Kurtz reconstructs the stories, as we heard, of many survivors. He employs both personal and historical narrative. And in reflecting on this process, Dr. Kurtz writes this: even the stories that have been preserved exist against a background of silence. Large swaths of each person's experience fall away and are forgotten. In the story I now have to tell, we confront at each moment the edge of what can be expressed and what so many years later it is possible for us to know. He follows then with the story of Maury, We learned of the brutality of the Reserve Police Battalion 101, responsible for the murder of Maury's family and friends, a battalion who hunted tens of thousands of human beings, treating them in ways that is truly beyond the edge of human comprehension. But in Maury's story, we also learn of this boy who escaped the Warsaw ghetto with his brother, at one point actually returning to the ghetto because his brother wanted to return to his family and accompanying him, then escaping again. We learn about the assistance that Maury and others like him received as he was hidden in hay bales, given bread and water and farm work, and eventually a new identity. Those who helped Maury were dozens and dozens of people, mainly Polish Catholics. On the edge of what can be expressed are stories of horror, and around those edges are the stories of the willingness of Catholics and other persons of faith, as we have heard this evening. The willingness to risk their lives to save Jews. Interfaith stories. In this age of growing nationalism and deepening tribalism, both abroad and in our own country, we need these stories of interfaith connection and compassion and cooperation and risk along the edges of the stories of anti-Semitism and bigotry. We need to hear stories of people standing together, such as after gunfire erupted during Shabbat services at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, just 2 weeks before the remembrance of Kristallnacht in 2018, how two Muslim organizations raised over $200,000 to help the families of the victims. And how hundreds and thousands of Christians and persons of faith all across the country showed up for Shabbat the week after that event in Pittsburgh to show their support for their Jewish neighbors. We need to hear how people of faith surrounded mosques in support when 6 months after the Pittsburgh shootings, 49 people were killed by more horrific gun violence at mosques in Christchurch, New Zealand. And how members of the Pittsburgh Jewish community themselves joined with people around the world to donate $1 million to the Muslim families, the Muslim victims' families in Christchurch. Through interfaith connection and support, we survive, we thrive, and we find hope. We need to hear the stories of atrocities and of interfaith healing, to tell them, to unearth them, to read about them, to live them. We need the stories that are on the edge of what can be expressed. So let us commit that wherever humans are targets of bigotry, we will stand as interfaith partners. And together, we look toward the day that they will cease, declaring that a night like Kristallnacht will never, ever happen again. May the mercy and the peace and the blessing of God be upon us all this day and forever. Amen. We will conclude our program with a recording from 2013 of Cantor Leopold Schneer, who you saw in the video earlier, chanting the El Malei Rachamim, the Hebrew prayer for the soul of the departed. We can think of no more fitting conclusion to our evening of remembrance of the events that occurred 83 years ago and of hope for our future when we stand united as an interfaith community. So we ask you to stand and to listen in silence. Afterwards, please join us in the vestibule for a book signing and outside on the patio for an informal reception and conversation. And so please rise as you are able.
Hey.
rachamim shochem b'meromim hametzei menuchot nechono tachas kanefei Ashkino Bemalos Kedoshim Kedoshim Utori Kezohar Horoki Masiri Esni Shmos Acheinu V'yach Yoseinu Acheinu V'yach Yoseinu Shenehergo V'shenishikho oto V'shenisero ofo Biat rotzchim ha-germanim al kidush ha-shem v'gan eden teye menuchosom lochein luchein balurachamim yastirem beseiser knofo Le'olomim Ve'yitzeror Bitzror Hachayim Esen yishmoseihem Adonai V'yunuchu v'sholom al mishkevoseihem v'namar oh.